at some level, one's own perception of one's attractiveness
sure.
is going to play a part in one's
yes.
exploration of one's sexuality.
Yes.
And I was really fat as a kid, like
okay.
super fat
right.
as a kid.
Okay.
And I, mm-hmm. my brother used to call me sumo. That's how fat I was. Like, I was like Humpty Dumpty as a kid.
Okay.
And I lost some weight, a puberty hit, and you kind of grew taller
yeah.
and whatever. But it was a kind of sudden transformation in a way where
sure.
around, I don't know, 15, 16, 17-ish, I like lost a bunch of weight.
Sure.
And that's right around the time when the hormones are going crazy. And so suddenly from being like the ugly duckling that nobody wanted
right.
to talk to, guys are like suddenly talking to you. And I felt like so hungry for that validation. Like,
sure.
oh my God, they think I'm pretty,
uh-huh.
you know?
Uh-huh.
And I think pretty girls who'd like been conventionally attractive all through their childhood wouldn't much less
because
like,
they were used to the attention. Right, sure.
And I think it definitely can sort of played a part in my own level mm-hmm. of confidence or,
okay.
you know, I mean, I'm just curious about, you said you were a late bloomer and stuff
mm-hmm.
like that. Do you think that body image and, I don't know, the way you see yourself and how,
sure.
and sort of how your own estimation of your own attractiveness,
yeah.
do you think that plays a part for men as much as it does for women?
But personally speaking, yeah, absolutely. Because I think there's a huge sort of link between how sort of desirable you perceive yourself to be and sort of how desirable you feel then when you approach somebody that you sort of want to have sex with or that you think sex is a possibility with. I think, like for example, I was kind of overweight in school and I had a lot of sort of body image issues in school without getting into detail. A lot of body image issues getting into school. Also, I was not living in an extremely permissive culture. So it was a combination of one, not feeling attractive, and two, sort of living in a culture where it just felt like the permissiveness for sex was low. As a result of which, it just made sex scary for me. Because on the one hand, I was like, the second these clothes come off, I'm going to be judged because of my weight, because of all of those things. And plus, I don't know when the opportunity for these clothes to come off in the first place will ever arise because I feel like I live in circles and a society where there is not that much permissiveness for at least premarital sex. Which is pretty much the only two prisms sex was viewed in the 90s. Like there was basically the sex you had after marriage or there was pop. Those were your two options, right? Those were your two options, essentially. I think definitely body image. And it's still to date. There's still days where I'm standing in front of a mirror and I'm like, is this a body that is attractive?
I lost a ton of weight
exactly. Was that a personal goal for you
or what?
It was a personal goal, one for health reasons, because I was at the heaviest weight I'd ever been at and I was just trying to do like dunk a simple basketball hoop and I sprained my ankle so hard while doing it. I was lying there in agony going, when did I become this unfit? Plus it was also playing into confidence issues. Every time I looked in the mirror and I went, this is, and again, yes, you should love your body, you should do all of those things. But I just fell into that trap where I was like, this is not an attractive body to anyone. I don't like how my body looks. How is somebody else going to like it? And more than look, it was, I don't like how I feel with this sort of weight on me because I used to be a little thinner. I used to be a little active. I used to do all of those things. But wow, honest confession story time. I had
my favorite.
What can only be best described as epic man boobs. And that sounds funny. We had opposite problems
yeah,
in school.
Man,
we really
seriously.
Had opposite problems in school. We should have been in each other's place. Our lives would have been way chill. But no, and it was just sort of funny at first, but then it sort of became a bullying tactic in school with some of the kids where it started to make me very conscious. Where, so say for example, in PE while we were like changing to go or whatever, a couple of kids would sort of run up and like, you know, grope them, press them and run away and like make snide these things about
That's
it, which really, I feel like kids are assholes.
Kids are assholes
because kids are ignorant, like in the sense that, and in that sense, on some level, I almost believe that childish cruelty is worse than adult cruelty because it comes from a place of such ignorance that they have no way of tempering it. That kids have, and I speak from the perspective of who I'm sure I've been cruel to 100 other kids when I was a kid. I'm not saying I was some sort of this thing. I'm sure I've bullied 100 other kids and you don't realize when you're a child, right? What language does or what you're saying does, any of those things. But yeah, all of that used to happen in school, and that like really, really affected like my body confidence, to the point where there were days where I was like, where I'd go up to my parents and say stuff like, I'm not going for PE this week. Like, I can't stand to be in that situation. And I'd go home and cry.
And swimming, like the idea of wearing a swimsuit because I was so fat. I was like, no.
Yeah, I'm sure that's scary, right? It's daunting.
And as a kid, for some reason, it's much, right now, I like couldn't give a fuck who sees me.
But that's because you're actualized as a person now, right? And you know that you don't tie your value down to that. But as a kid,
even though you're not like, interested in sexual attention or anything, you're still so self-conscious.
Extremely,
you know?
Extremely. And it's interesting you should say that, because I have no idea where that comes from. Where do we learn
Why do you care?
Where do you learn that in like the 7th or the 8th standard that your sort of body and your looks matter so much? And I think it just comes from a place where, because it's the easiest thing for people around you to weaponize against you. You know, your appearances, and this is a fact. And we've all done it. We've all had it done to us. Like so many times, you just like first insult about somebody you want to do a weight is, hey fatty, what are you saying?
Exactly.
Hey this, hey that. So I think that's where it comes from. But and again, it's just one of those things. What are you gonna do? It's one of like small things that happen in your childhood stay with you and have ramifications through your life. And again, like I look back, and I'm still friends with some of those kids, right? Mm-hmm. Who used to do that to me, and I'm like, we were young then; they didn't know what they were doing. So you can't hate them for it. But there are very real consequences. I'm sure there is somebody living with very real consequences of the bullying I did, right?
It's funny though, from the perspective of someone who doesn't know you well, say, and especially since you're a public figure and really popular, you know, in the space that you operate in, young people probably look at your life and like, oh, wow, Rohan Joshi, like what problems could he have? He probably could pick up any chick he wants, you know? And so
hilarious.
Like, no, you know what I mean, though.
Yeah, no, I know what you mean.
Okay, so two questions. One, do you think that, how did success and fame and all of that, do you think that impacted how you see yourself as well as how others see you? I want you to address both elements.
Definitely. I think it true on both counts. It definitely impacts the way you see yourself, because for one, at least you're a little relieved that there are other things you can place your self-worth on. Right now, it's no longer just about my body or my looks or any of that. I've achieved things in my life. I've done things. My sense of self-worth comes from those things now as well. This doesn't change the fact that you will look at the mirror and have a terrible day and have terrible feelings. But you can at least, when you're going to bed feeling miserable, you can tell yourself, but I have money in my bank account. But I have this cool thing. 4 people asked me photographs today, and I'm working on something that I think is really, really, really going to bring laughs to a lot of people. So there immediately, right, you have other things to peg yourself worth on. In terms of other people processing you, it just, and this is obviously a recent phenomenon for me because I've only recently started dating. But what happens is you become a little more careful in the sense that you ask yourself, are people here? Are people here because they are just genuinely interested in talking to me? Or are people here because on some level in their head, they think it's a great laugh and a great story to just be out on a date with that guy from AIB? I'm not a movie star, so it's not like they're after me for my money or my extreme fame. But it's a question that crosses into your head, where is this person here because they just genuinely enjoyed talking to me? Or is this person here because my name has a certain amount of cultural cachet to it? And which is why I think it comes back to the same thing. Do you have mechanisms in your life that can contextualize your fears and insecurities and allow you to look past them and have healthy relationships, whether those relationships are sexual or based on love?
And I think in some ways, while probably men have it easier in many departments than women do, in terms of exposing or being comfortable exposing their vulnerabilities, I think men actually perhaps are at a slight disadvantage because they're sort of discouraged from being open about feeling any sort of...
Any feeling is seen as weakness, right?
Any feeling is seen as weakness, being emotional about anything or... Even having, confidence issues around sexuality men is seen as like...
And I just want to... There's no wood here to touch, no pun intended. But I am extremely grateful. And this is the one thing that... If I could give one advice that I've definitely learned from life is find yourself a peer group or a friends group that is not afraid to discuss these things emotionally and openly. Fuck, I can't begin to tell you what a difference it makes that I happen to be part of a sort of friend circle and a peer group. And this is a mixed group. It's not just guys, not just girls, who will very happily sit around discussing their own like feelings of sexual inadequacy or their own fears around love, lust and sex. Because to just hear somebody else say it what you've been thinking makes you just so much more comfortable. Just that feeling of, fuck, it's not just me.
Hmm.
You know, sometimes just that can be so liberating. That sense of, it's not just me that's terrified about performance, that's terrified about the days where it doesn't work, that's terrified about the days where it doesn't feel like your partner had a good time. Or even just talking about the fact that there are days where I don't want sex. Which, weirdly enough, as a guy who's aging, is sometimes one of the toughest things to admit, right, to your own ego. It's like, what? Can my sex drive be failing me? Surely not. Surely not. That happens. But the same question sort of...
Eat a lot. I mean,
you don't eat a lot and you're fine.
No, I'm saying if you eat a lot, you don't want to have sex.
Oh, God. Which
is like... take like...
Running joke in my friend circle is if you want to have sex at the end of a date, never go for Indian food.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
Indian food is the worst date food because... like,
you can barely move. Forget about like doggy.
Yeah, once butter chicken is on the table, sex is off the table. Like, this is a fact. This is just a fact. Like, the best pre-sex food is sushi because it's just the perfect proportion of carb, protein, and a little bit of vegetable.
It kind of tastes
on
like
the
sex,
side. And it kind of tastes like sex. Also, it's perfect if it's done right. Otherwise, send the fish back.
Okay, so if there's one thing or several things that you could change about the way young people have to deal with their sexuality in India, what would it be?
Two main things that I've changed. One is I would definitely push for sort of just better, significantly better sort of integrated sex education programs in schools, in colleges, just availability of that information anywhere in as many languages as possible. Because one of the things that research shows is that by the time people have access to information about sex, it's way too late. Because like we said, we live in a country where people are getting pregnant at the ages of 14 and 15. When that is happening, it's kind of absurd to me to say that schools should not have. Because it's absurd to me that you could emerge from school pregnant without having had access to sex education.
I mean, we're in a country with a population of
1.4 billion now?
No, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so obviously everybody's having sex.
Of course, And the thing is, we don't know how much of that sex is consensual or safe.
Exactly.
And when I say safe, I mean physically, emotionally, for the people who are having it. We don't have answers to those questions. And the other thing I would change is, and this is actually a super easy change that literally anybody can make. If whoever you are watching this, any question, if somebody has a question about sex, no matter how stupid it sounds, no matter how absurd it sounds, no matter how this thing, even if you want to have a laugh about it, because I get it, some questions just sound absurd. After you're done having that laugh about it, actually address the question and make that person feel like they get a proper answer. Because the worst thing about sex is just that stigma of people feeling like they can't ask. And I just feel like the openness in the conversation would be 10x. If everybody felt like there was a peer they could honestly talk to without getting laughed at about any sexual insecurity, I think that would, man, that would change so many things so quickly. So
I couldn't agree more, and it's such a sort of, it's an element that's so central to the purpose of this channel.
This is true.
And I mean, once all of that stuff is taken care of, sex can be such, and love and sex and all of it can be such a source of joy and wonder, and it's one of the best parts of life.
It really can be.
Yeah, so I hope we can help you. If you need answers to questions, send them to Rohan and me.
Yeah, or leave them in the comments.
I hope you liked this video. Please give it a big thumbs up if you did. And don't forget to subscribe to my channel. And Rohan, thank you so much.
Like, share, subscribe.
For being here.
Pleasure was all mine.
Next time, guys.